Welcome back friends to my channel. In today's topic we are going to discuss what is auxiliary winding in alternators. So on your screen you can see there are two wires A1 and A2. Those two wires A1 and A2 are your auxiliary winding lead wires. So in today's topic I will explain you all why auxiliary winding is used in alternators. So basically whenever we come across any alternator which has two wires, mostly A1 and A2, coming out from the main stator and going to your AVR, I have noticed that many engineers get confused with these two wires. So if you people have seen my earlier video on AVR, automatic voltage regulator, you must have observed that any ordinary basic AVR will have only 5 wires. 2 will be your phase wires, 1 will be your neutral wire, and 2 will be your exciter stator wires. So total 5 wires. So whenever we find more than 5 wires in any of your alternators, first thing we have to do is trace those wires. In case the wires are traced back to the stator winding, we must assume that those wires are your auxiliary winding wires. So in some models, the like what we have taken in this video, this is a McCulty alternator model. This has two wires coming from the main stator. That means the auxiliary winding leads have two markings, A1, A2. Same way in the case of Prompton Greaves, we have X1, X2. And in the case of Leroy Sommer, we have two auxiliary windings. So that will be X1, X2 and Z1, Z2. So depending on the model, the number of wires or the number of auxiliary windings can change. So basically, it is only one auxiliary winding with two leads, but sometimes companies use two auxiliary windings, so total 4 leads. So first thing what we have to do is trace out the extra wires, and if these wires are coming out from the main stator, then we have to consider this as your auxiliary winding wires. Now we have taken Leroy Sommer alternator as our subject. So in this alternator we will see that there are two auxiliary windings. So as on nameplate you can see this is a 150 kVA alternator and this is having two auxiliary windings. So this first wire, as you can see, is your phase wire, the V phase wire, which is going to your AVR. Then the second one is your W phase wire. So these two wires are going to your AVR. Now this Z2, X1, Z1, X2. So for that matter it will be X1, X2, Z1, Z2. So total 4 wires are going to your AVR. So these 4 wires are nothing but your auxiliary winding, and in this particular model there are two auxiliary windings. So as we can trace the wires back to the stator winding, so now we know that the auxiliary windings are coming from our main stator winding. So in this particular AVR there will be 4 wires of your auxiliary. 2 will be from your phase and 2 will be from your exciter stator. So now let's see how the auxiliary winding is done. Let's take an example of a burnt alternator and I'll try to show you all the auxiliary wires in it. So in this video you can see there are 3 wires. So this will be your RYB, then the next 3 will be your neutral cables,
and then there are two leftover wires. So this is your E1, E2. So this wire coming from the main stator is your auxiliary winding. So this is your main stator and the rewinding process is going on. Here we can see there is a small coil on your left corner, and your bottom you can see. So this is your phase coil, your RYB phase. So that this coil is your phase coil. So there are many more layers of wire which are be placed above it, and this small group, this two wires, this is your auxiliary winding. So this is your auxiliary winding. There will be four such kind of coils. So this three, this is the third one, and there will be the fourth one. So this is our third one. Here you can see there are very few turns, and this is our fourth one. So all these coils will be reconnected, and depending upon the model, so if this is only single auxiliary design, so only two wires A1 and A2 will be going to your AVR. So if this was a Larosommer model which has two auxiliary in it, more coils would have gone, and according to the design the connection would have been made. So in this winding, the notable thing is there are very few turns going into making of these coils, so hence generating a small voltage, a voltage which is fed to your AVR. So now we are going to see what is the actual views of auxiliary winding. So friends, here you can see I have just noted down the five basic wires which go into our AVR connections. So first is our phase wire, then the second is also a phase wire. So this is U phase, second is V phase. This is just for an example. You can choose any two phase from the alternator terminal, and those two phases can go into your AVR. So this same has been explained in my earlier video which I have made on AVRs. So the third wire is our F1, which is exciter stator, which goes from the exciter stators. Then F2, this also goes from our exciter stator, and our neutral. So this five wire are your basic AVR connections. So now talking about the auxiliary winding. So let's see why there was a need for auxiliary winding. So basically what happens is we take any one phase and our neutral, and these two wires are used. The purpose of these two wire is operating voltage for our AVR. So what happens exactly is AVR takes these two wires, and these two voltages are used for AVR to operate. So now let's see what was the requirement of inventing the auxiliary winding. So let's take an example wherein our terminal voltage of the alternator is 415 volt. So the RPM will be 1500, and whatever is the load, standard load. So suppose there is a case wherein the load increases, or there is a sudden jerk in load. So this sudden jerk in load will tend to reduce our alternator, our engine RPM. So for example, let's consider this as a drop in RPM at 1400 revolutions per minute. So as the load has increased, or as there is a sudden jerk of load, the engine RPM has dropped, and hence these two conditions will lead to the decrease in terminal voltage. So now the terminal voltage is 380. So let's consider this as an example as 380. So when the load has increased, the RPM has decreased, and the terminal voltage has decreased, this low voltage will be sensed by our sensing wires in the AVR, and it will give a signal to the engine, and the engine will start to recover the RPM, and after few seconds it will achieve 1500 again. This phenomena, wherein the load increases and decreases leading to the RPM fluctuation and then the voltage fluctuation, will lead to our AVR malfunction. So to prevent this, the companies had come up with something called as auxiliary winding. So to overcome this voltage fluctuation issue in main terminals of alternator, companies came up with something called as auxiliary winding. So in this example, we'll just consider A1 and A2. This A1 and A2 will give operating voltage to AVR, as this auxiliary winding is placed inside main stator. So there will be a voltage generation which is generated in auxiliary winding will be given to AVR as its operating voltage. So the auxiliary winding is designed in such a way that even if alternator RPM drops, even if the RPM of engine is 1500, voltage across A1, A2, let's consider it as 90 volt, and if the RPM drops to 1400, the voltage across A1, A2 will still be 90 volt. Still, if the RPM drops to 1300, voltage across A1, A2 will still remain as 190 volt. This winding is designed in such a way that the RPM can drop to a certain limit and keeping the auxiliary voltage stable. So this stable voltage will give a stable output to the AVR, and hence the AVR will function in a smooth way without disrupting its internal devices. So we all know that fluctuating voltage is the biggest reason for our electronic components to fail. So the same reason was with the AVRs, and hence the auxiliary winding was invented to overcome this fluctuating voltage issue. So friends, hope you like this video. I hope that all your doubts are cleared. If not, then please comment me below. Thanks for watching.